right? What chances have those sticks writing, I love you? Right. In DNA, you've got 3 billion bits of information in DNA. It's more complex than that sentence, I love you. So, how can it be logical that you're saying that chance cannot produce I love you by sticks thrown on the floor, but yet chance can produce 3 billion bits of information in DNA? It's more complex than that sentence.
Because, you know, laws of physics,
like,
you drop a bunch of sticks and
you're going to
drop
a mile,
that's the laws of nature.
Yeah, but when you say laws of nature, you're invoking a mind. More information is mind. Information is data in terms of mind. Yeah? So, laws of nature cannot write information. It takes a mind. Well, show me where you can have a computer code without a mind. Because information requires a mind. If you look at a logical formula, or if you look at some information by reading, information is put there by mind. So when you're saying laws of nature, even if I granted you that, you've still got a problem. Before the laws of nature, before anything existed, there was nothing. And nothing means chance. So how can chance produce information?
I'm realizing that, like, accurate as Summer said, how basically there are so many, like, different possibilities and whatever, and you're only really going to know one that happens. Okay. You're not going to be around to experience any of the others, so that has to be one.
Say that again.
It's like basically like the whole like creation of the universe or whatever, like how everyone's saying like, oh, it's just like such a small chance that happened, like just like randomly by chance.
That's a presumption. Let's stick to what we know. What we know is where there is information, there is a mind. Yeah? There is information in the universe. Right. There must have been a mind. But what you're saying is, it just happened, it's the way it is. I'm inferring, I'm reasoning from nature that there's information that implies a mind.
Okay, so if you were to do that, then why does that then have to lead to some omnipotent, like, deity?
Because mind, if it's mind, then we ask the question, was it material or immaterial? Then we know by the law of thermodynamics that everything's cooling down and everything at the beginning.
Right?
It's the most strongest law that we have.
Right?
So if there was a beginning, it could not have been material, it had to be immaterial.
Right.
And if it's a mind, then it's immaterial, it gets you God.
Right, so then aren't you subjecting God to, like, the laws of the universe to have this God to, like,
transcendence? No, not transcendence to say it's immaterial, but we're referring to evidence in nature. Yeah? So, when you give me some evidence for evolution.
I
really respect you. You're a highly intelligent person. This is one of the most enjoyable debates I've ever had. But you can tell me, give me some evidence. And if you can, I'll give you something specific to make you think, right? Give me something specific about evolution.
I don't know, science is
right. Let me ask, well, it's not my strong point, but right. Right. There's evolution, there's two types, yeah? There's macro and micro. Micro is when little rabbits change into bigger rabbits or whatever. Macro is when rabbits change into dinosaurs over time. Yeah? Right. Now, my question is this, right? Is what is the mathematical probability that mutation and natural selection can produce macro evolution? What's the mathematical probability? When you look at mutations, you have billions of mutations happening in your body.
No,
and maybe one will stick and then change the body. Right? So that's billions, yeah?
All right.
So multiply that into human beings, billions of.
Does he want it back? I don't know if he wants it back now. He can have it back, I was just using it before.
Alright, okay. By chance,
it's there from the stick. It's there over on the floor near the thing, but I wasn't nicking it off of me.
No. I think he was just wondering.
Changes within the body
is going to be here for a while anyway.
Oh yeah, we're here for a few hours, yeah, hopefully.
There was a mathematician and engineer who met in 1966 with the evolution. They weren't creationists, they were atheists, and they met, yeah? And they calculated that it's virtually impossible that if you do it mathematically that it could ever produce a change in life effect. And the evolutionist just didn't listen to it. And it's still on the table now. And even today, evolutionists still debate these issues because they don't really want to hear it. I'll give you another example. Research in 1980
How do you know?
To multiply bacteria. And they can multiply bacteria and it could be equivalent to a million years. So they started in 1980, they're still doing it now, and they're hoping that bacteria would change into a bumblebee or something. Something changed, but it's still bacteria. After 40,000 generations, which is the equivalent to a million years. Now,